Welcome back to the Breakfast Club. We have such an exciting story to share with you today. These are our people of interest, two women. We're on the cusp of history as we speak as two Indian Navy women officers. This is Lieutenant Commander Rupa A and Lieutenant Commander Dilna K. As we speak, they're going to be embarking on an extraordinary journey today. They're circumnavigating the globe on board INSV Tarini. It's a journey that's going to take them 8 months. It's a daring expedition. It's been called Navika Sagar Parikrama 2, and it marks a significant milestone in India's ocean sailing enterprise and maritime endeavours. There have already been pioneering efforts from sail training ships INS Tarangini, INS Sudarshini, and you've also had groundbreaking circumnavigation that's taken place in the past. This is on board INSV's Mahadevi and Tarini. India has already taken centre stage in ocean sailing expeditions in the last few years, but this one is particularly special.
So, our guests today, Lieutenant Commander Rupa A and Lieutenant Commander Dilna K, have undergone rigorous training, gaining thousands of miles of experience and mentorship from ace circumnavigators who've done this before them. We'll be joining by both of them to understand this in a little bit more detail. Let's welcome them on the program. Hi, good morning. Thanks so much for joining us. And firstly, what a day to be speaking. You actually get on board and start your journey today. So, Lieutenant Commander Rupa, let me start with you. 8 months on sea, not easy, but for mango people like us, give us a little bit on what kind of mental preparation really is required to undertake a journey like this.
What happens at sea is there's only you and the boat and the vast expanse of the ocean, and there's very much to distract you. There's not much distractions available at sea other than you and the boat. So what happens is you go into a lot of introspective mode. There's a lot of thoughts which are going on, and also there's a lot of things which are happening on the boat. Not any one day is not monotonous on the boat. You keep doing something, and which makes you mentally alert. You keep on thinking like what might go wrong, so that you have this sense of vision to look in the future, to be, you know, well prepared. So all of this keeps going on in your mind, and so you are mentally very active at sea. And but yes, it gives you a lot of time to know yourself better, because I feel that when you're sailing alone or when you're sailing in a group, it is a very closed space, and it really brings out the true character of a person at sea. So you really can't hide from yourself at sea.
Wow, those are profound words. You're also joining us from on board as we speak. Lieutenant Commander Dilna, if we could ask you, both of you are going to be alone with each other for 8 months. The working dynamic that you both share in the next few months is going to be of prime importance. What is that relationship like?
Yes, definitely. Because we are really, when we go for sailing as in a dual-handed mode, it's just two of us in the boat. So everything has to be managed by ourselves, and we follow the watch system on board. So at all point of time, one person is always there, and it doesn't happen that way all the time, because when the weather goes bad, two of us have to be on board, and we have to be there to look after the boat, and to navigate. If there is a storm, we have to navigate to the storm. So every time both of us are involved. So there are a lot of evolutions which happens during those times, and we don't have to tell each other what is to be done. We have reached a stage where we are already aware what is to be done, and it comes as an automatic pace. So yeah, so the coordination between both of us, it's like really working out well. So we are able to maintain our boat, and we are able to navigate through the rough weather in a very good way.
good tips there, and especially for Toya and I also to pick up from. But we should actually do this interview at the end of the voyage and understand how 8 months actually went between the two of you. But let's move on to the next question then. And this is for Lieutenant Commander Rupa. Now, could you explain to our audiences a little bit more about what it means to be navigating through the three great capes? There are a lot of challenges there, even for those who don't have perhaps the best nautical knowledge.
So the Cape is actually a geographical entity, like how we call it as a peninsula and a continent. And Cape is also a geographical entity. And there are known to be three great capes because all those three great capes are located in the Southern Ocean, which is well known for its wilderness and rough seas. And the three great capes are the Cape Leeuwin, which is in the western Australia. And second is the Cape Horn, which is the southernmost point of the South American mainland. And the Cape of Good Hope, which is the which is in South Africa. So these three capes have been historically known to be very challenging for the mariners and the sailors to be navigate through, and that's why they got famous to be, you know, like they were called as the three great capes. And how we prepare is the entire circumnavigation is planned as such to be navigated so that the Cape Horn is crossed at a particular month, which is the during the austral summer or when it is the summer in the southern hemisphere. So it is the most difficult part of the voyage. So we plan the entire voyage around this particular cape, and we get continuous weather updates, and we also have knowledge and studies of the previous circumnavigation and generally how the sailing passages are undertaken in that part of the world. So we use all this as a reference and forecasted weather, and we plan the passage around these caves.
Ostrich summer, that's the first time I've heard that phrase for the Australian summer. Can you just tell us though, why is it so treacherous? Exactly why? I know you're saying that there's lots that you need to consider, but what makes that region so tricky?
So in the southern oceans, the seas are always it comes along with a lot of fronts and storms and all. So the southern ocean, when you come to the southern latitude, the weather becomes very bad. When you go down to the latitudes like 40s and 50s, and it's called as roaring 40s, furious 50s, and screaming 60s. So, and the wind, when we go along to the east, the wind is always from the west. We get a downwind, so we'll be going, we're getting wind from behind, so the wind will be pushing us ahead. So so when you come towards southern oceans, the wind pattern, everything changes, and so it's always it's always rough.
So, Lieutenant Commander Rupa, then, do you have some words of wisdom for women who are a bit of an adventure junkie, just like you guys, and want to do something out of the box and who are watching you right now?
What I have learned is, I have been in situations in my life where I had to take hard decisions. But I always went with what my instinct or what my intuition said or what I wanted in my life. And one thing which I follow is like, I wouldn't want any regrets in life. Like, what if? So whatever opportunity presents towards you, presents in front of yourself, I think everybody should go for it rather than, you know, later feel that what if I would have done that. So unless you go and do it, you will never know what you are capable of or what your strengths are. So
agreed.
I would say any young person that you should explore and find out for yourself what your strengths are and what your capabilities are. And that you'll know only when you try for yourself.
All right, we'll leave it there for the moment. Thank you both for joining us. Good luck with your voyage. The entire country will be sort of cheering for you, especially all the women adventure junkies will be looking out to see how this actually pans out. Thanks so much.